Do you know Ship 28 and Booster 10 is about to launch? Yes, you heard it right. NASA is planning for a national laboratory in low Earth orbit. Hey, I'm Lucas. Welcome to the SpaceX community. Let's get started. I think you all may be knowing about the next Starship's super heavy prototype assigned for Orbital Flight 3. Okay, if you don't know, it's Ship 28 and Booster 10. So, Ship 28 recently moved to Suborbital Pad B for engine testing, before its third test flight. It's been through two tough cryo-proof tests and got some upgrades during its 2.5 months at the Sanchez site. Just 2 days ago, SpaceX did a static fire test for Ship 28. It was a 6-engine static fire, which went pretty well. Now let's talk about Booster 10. It was moved from the rocket garden to the launch pad a few days ago, and using those chopstick arms, they hoisted it onto the orbital launch mount. However, yesterday's plan for a static fire test hit a snag. Some issues popped up before LOX loading could finish, leading to an unusual detank of B-10. Although a road closure was scheduled today for a possible reattempt, it didn't happen. I think they are currently figuring out the issue and hope they will solve it before the next closure. Okay, now about the next closure, SpaceX has scheduled one for December 27th, after the Christmas holidays. I'm pretty amazed at how fast SpaceX is moving. They're getting ready for the third orbital launch of Starship Super Heavy, really quick. It's all pretty exciting, and I can't wait to see what happens next. Launch tower updates. So, recent observations of ongoing work on the Starship launch tower at Starbase unveil both progress and challenges. Notably, the tower components exhibit signs of maintenance, with notable occurrences such as missing piping and a disconnected hood. These indicators prompt speculation about potential issues arising from debris accumulation or damage caused by the intense heat generated during launches. The attention to addressing the ship quick disconnect arm, which suffered damage in a previous launch, underscores the importance of real-world testing in refining and enhancing design elements. Starship launch site restoration. SpaceX Starship launch site at Starbase is currently undergoing extensive restoration efforts following the second Starship launch. The launch table, located at Stage Zero, serves as the heart of the launch site and undergoes repainting after each engine test due to the intense heat generated by the 33 Raptor engines. This heat strips away protective paint, leading to rapid oxidation, commonly known as rust. The launch table's appearance suggests weathering over years, though it has only been a few days since the last test. The proximity to the ocean exacerbates the rusting issue. Crews are actively repairing cracks formed during launches, emphasizing the critical need for structural integrity, as the legs must support the launch table and a fully fueled Starship weighing approximately 7,500 tons. This phase of the tower's maintenance serves as a testament to SpaceX's commitment to continuous improvement and the rigorous testing necessary for space exploration endeavors. The challenges encountered, such as the disconnected hood and damaged quick disconnect arm, highlight the demanding conditions that the equipment faces during actual launch scenarios. Simultaneously, ongoing water deliveries to the deflector system suggest proactive measures in preparation for forthcoming tests, emphasizing SpaceX's dedication to thorough pre-launch preparations and the importance of safeguarding critical systems. Launch schedule and delays. Kathy Luders, the Starbase general manager, revealed SpaceX's efforts to obtain launch licenses for the third and fourth Starship launches. These missions are crucial for testing technologies related to NASA's Human Landing System program, including in-orbit propellant transfer demonstrations. While Elon Musk initially suggested a possible launch readiness by December, a more realistic timeframe is the first quarter of 2024, aligning with Luders' projections. The increased launch frequency signals potential advancements, with the third Starship mission expected in late February or early March. Exponential growth and logistical challenges. SpaceX's trajectory of exponential growth, as witnessed with Falcon 9 launches, foretells a comparable ascent for Starship. While the prospect of such growth is promising, it presents intricate logistical challenges, particularly concerning the refurbishment of the launch tower. Kathy Luder's affirmation of a second tower under development assumes pivotal importance in addressing this bottleneck, underscoring SpaceX's ambition to replicate the swift advancement seen in Falcon 9 launches. The strategic deployment of additional infrastructure becomes imperative for sustaining and managing the anticipated surge in Starship launches. Second launch tower development. The revelation of a second launch tower ushers in complexities linked to site selection, with considerations encompassing the ecological aspects of wetlands and salt flats. Initially proposed in 2021, the exact location of this second tower remains elusive. The intricacies involved in its construction, from ground leveling and stability pile integration to the tower's erection, denote a substantial undertaking. These developments not only influence the Starbase landscape, but also portend potential disruptions and enhancements to ongoing testing at the existing launch tower. Relocation of engine testing. Kathy Luder's proposition to relocate engine testing to Massey's signifies a strategic effort to alleviate beach closures, offering a glimpse into the broader logistics of SpaceX's operations. This decision prompts speculation on the plausible location for the second tower. The interconnectedness of engine testing relocation, advancements in subcoolers, and preparations for propellant tanks suggests the prospect of constructing an entirely new launch pad at Massey's, injecting an element of anticipation and curiosity into the unfolding narrative of Starship's future endeavors. Decommissioning of Suborbital Pad A. The recent decommissioning of Suborbital Pad A heralds a notable transformation in the configuration of Starbase's testing facilities. Speculation arises regarding the potential relocation of Pad B to Massey's, possibly designated for the second stage zero. Such a move could streamline construction processes, enabling parallel work on tank placement and tower foundations. This strategic shift not only alters the physical landscape of Starbase, but also underscores SpaceX's adaptability in optimizing its testing infrastructure. Kennedy Space Center, tank transportation. The recent transport of tanks from the Kennedy Space Center to Starbase triggers inquiries into their intended destination. Whether earmarked for the primary launch site or potentially Massey's, these tanks play a pivotal role in accommodating the heightened frequency of testing. The imperative to minimize road closures, balancing public access with testing requirements, adds a layer of complexity to logistical considerations. The tanks, with their undisclosed purpose, symbolize the evolving logistical intricacies inherent in SpaceX's quest to propel the Starship program into a new era of space exploration and innovation. Now let's go through some updates from NASA. NASA recently conducted a study to explore options for maintaining a national laboratory in low Earth orbit, LEO, once the International Space Station, ISS, is retired. However, the study didn't recommend a specific option. The report, released on December 20th by NASA's Office of Technology, Policy and Strategy, is an initial assessment directed by the National Space Council. The 154-page report looked into six models for a future national lab in LEO, which would utilize facilities on commercial space stations known as Commercial LEO Destinations, CLDs, or other spacecraft. These models ranged from NASA leasing space on a commercial station to providing grants for users to lease facilities on CLDs independently. The study evaluated these models based on five criteria, including NASA's needs and equity, using three growth scenarios for overall commercial LEO activities. Cost considerations were not explicitly included. The model that performed the best across all scenarios was the government research broker. In this model, NASA acts as a broker to organize the deployment of experiments on CLDs or other commercial spacecraft, similar to NASA's Launch Services Program for acquiring launches. According to the report, the government research broker offers a reliable option for NASA to continue activities in LEO under any future scenario, meeting most stakeholder-driven performance criteria, with the exception of market sustainability, as it may compete with CLD providers in some aspects. Thanks for watching today's episode. Don't forget to subscribe and give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Stay tuned for another great video tomorrow.